Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Coastal Studies Institute. My name is Nathan Richards. I'm the program head in the Maritime Heritage Program at the Coastal Studies Institute. I'm also an associate professor in the program Maritime Studies at East Carolina University. I'd like to welcome you to the sixth in our series of our Underwater Heritage Maritime Archaeology presentation series. Before we actually talk about the presenter, I'd like to thank our sponsors. This lecture series is only made possible through a grant from the Outer Banks Community Foundation, and also with the assistance of the UNC Coastal Studies Institute, East Carolina University, and our partner, the North Carolina Maritime Museum in Hatteras, the graveyard of the Atlantic Museum. For those of you that don't know, every presentation that we have in this series, they're presented twice. One is at 11 o'clock on the same day, and then we have the 6 o'clock presentation here at CSI. Tonight, we're going to be listening to John Bright. John Bright was a graduate student in East Carolina University. He was my advisee. I won't tell you too many stories about that, but between 2009 and 2012, he carried out his graduate thesis research on a convoy battle off the coast of North Carolina called the KS-520 convoy battle. Following that, he went to the Submerged Resources Center of the National Park Service. And then as of 6 months ago, he joined NOAA at the Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary up in Alpena, Michigan. I'm going to hand it across to John and he can take it away from there.
All right.
Actually, two other things. We're going to keep questions to the end, please, because we are live streaming this and we're going to have some questions come over the web, potentially. And also, if you could silence your cell phones, that would be much appreciated. Thank you. Oh, that's for the web. Sorry.
Okay. We on here? Do this the old-fashioned way then. All right, good evening everyone, and thank you for coming out, and thank you to the UNC Coastal Studies Institute and all the other sponsors for allowing me to come here this evening and talk with you guys, and also for allowing me to come to the Graveyard of the Atlantic Museum this morning and give the same presentation. So Nathan gave you guys a little bit of backstory about my academic training and where I work as a maritime archaeologist, first with the Park Service and now with the National Marine Sanctuaries Program in Alpena, Michigan. A little more backstory, I think, is necessary to really explain the genesis of research. Suffice to say that a maritime archaeologist who used to live in Denver, who now works in Michigan, isn't researching World War I shipwrecks in North Carolina as part of their 9-to-5 job. In fact, I began working on the Outer Banks in 2008 and 2009 as a dive master, instructor, and deckhand with the Outer Banks Dive Center. That was led by Bill McDermott, was the owner-operator, who you see in the top left there. And as most people get interested, or some people rather, get interested in North Carolina shipwrecks, they do so by experiencing them firsthand, by going diving upon them, seeing them. And there's a particular draw to the mystery of unknown shipwrecks, shipwrecks that you're diving for the first time, or shipwrecks that you're on that you don't know the identity of it. And so there was one shipwreck in particular, what's locally known as the Green Buoy Wreck, south of Nag's Head, if you go out of Oregon Inlet down towards Diamond Shoals, that for many, many years we were uncertain what the identity of the wreck was. And some of the local theories had it that it was the remains of the World War I vessel Mirlo, a British tanker that was sunk by German U-117. So in years of diving and researching that wreck, we gained a lot of historical information about the Mirlo, about the events surrounding the Mirlo, which are locally known specifically for the rather amazing Coast Guard rescue that was effected to pick up the crew of the tanker after it was torpedoed. It broke into two pieces, let a cargo of gasoline and oil out into the water, which then started to burn, and the 52 crew that were on it had to abandon the ship into lifeboats and then navigate those rather treacherous flames. And with very skillful rescue, the crew of the Chickamaucomico life-saving station came and picked them up. So the location of the wreck is in many ways significant because of the events surrounding not only the attack, but then also the rescue of the crewmen on board. However, The Green Buoy site, as more research was done on it, ended up being found out that it was not actually the site of Mirlo. And in a rather nicely written article by Mike Barnett in Wreck Diver magazine in 2006, he lays out a case for determining that the Green Buoy wreck is actually that of a World War II tanker, the San Delfino. So as we were researching this, it was sort of a vexing proposition to determine that this was not the site we had thought was the Mirlo, and only sort of inspired me after leaving the Outer Banks Dive Center and going on to do graduate training and then going on into the professional field of maritime archaeology to always sort of wonder, where is Mirlo? So with that in mind, going into this research, you start to see a lot of broad trends coming out of the historical narrative of the Mirlo itself and things that are happening in the 20th century off of the North Carolina Outer Banks. And one of those broad themes is that there is consistently a very historically significant presence of the first the life-saving service and then the U.S. Coast Guard off the North Carolina coast. Just a short ways off of the northern Outer Banks here, you have the wrecks of two Coast Guard cutters, Jackson and Bedloe, that went down in a hurricane in 1944. Now, if you consider the wreck of, or the torpedoing of Mirlo and the subsequent rescue of its crew to be one of the more famous rescues, successes in Coast Guard history, the loss of the cutters Jackson and Bedloe constitute one of the most tragic losses of life associated with the entire Coast Guard service, where 48 guardsmen were lost in a single event, the sinking of those two ships. So off of one stretch of coast, the North Carolina coast, you have both the largest success and then one of the biggest tragedies of the United States Coast Guard. The Coast Guard was incorporated as a single service of several different life-saving and survey organizations within the U.S. government. One of those original organizations being the U.S. Life-Saving Service, which was operating up and down the eastern seaboard and then throughout the Great Lakes region. And we have a volunteer at our sanctuary in Thunder Bay, Mr. Chuck Wieson, who explained to me the Life-Saving Service as ordinary men doing extraordinary things. And what he meant to say by that was that, in his opinion, there was no other government service where ordinary people so consistently did such extraordinary things in the course of their duty, whether it was in the Great Lakes, in the Northern Atlantic, or in the Mid-Atlantic. It was a service that just had this storied history. And that is certainly certainly well known to anybody that is familiar with that history in North Carolina, as the sort of famous Harper's Weekly relief here shows, the guardsmen readying a surfboat to go through large breaking waves, the people of the life-saving service braving sometimes just unimaginably difficult conditions for the sake of helping other people. So you have that theme that you see recurring that is encapsulated within the Mirlo story. And then you have another sort of maritime theme that is sort of overlapping that, which is the histories of the First and Second World War as they played out off the coast of North Carolina. So in the case of Mirlo, you're dealing with World War I, but World War I and World War II, with respect to the North Carolina coast, played out in very similar ways. You had German U-boats coming across the Atlantic, targeting merchant shipping that's moving along the eastern seaboard, these wrecks then creating a substantial loss of life, and many of these vessels coming to rest on the bottom of the ocean. So just sort of a brief survey to give you kind of an illustrated version of where some of these locations are. These are just known commonly visited sites off the North Carolina coast associated with World War I and World War II. And that doesn't include artificial reefs or things like that. They're just sites associated with combat operations in World War I and World War II. So as part of our archaeological research when I was in graduate school, we sort of encounter the third one of these larger themes that you get with studying Mirlo, and that's taking an archaeological angle to researching what happened, not just the historical narrative of who, what, when, and how, but then looking into the whys and some of the human factors and how we can recreate some of the forensic evidence that we have in the historical records to gain a better understanding of the action as a sort of battlefield. If you can imagine going to, say, Gettysburg, looking out across the landscape and seeing the hills and the valleys and the tree lines and imagining where artillery and lines of infantry would position themselves, we can conduct a similar type of visualization in a digital space with a naval battlefield. If we went out off Cape Hatteras today on a sort of nice, flat, calm day, we would just see water, and if we were close enough, a little bit of land. The features of that landscape wouldn't reveal themselves to us in the sense that it wouldn't be obvious from the naked eye that there's ocean currents and bathymetric contours and there's shifting sandbars and shoals and there's these sort of fixed but loosely defined shipping lanes that move around aids to navigation, and there are concentrations of ships that move in convoys but transit in an ephemeral manner through the landscape. So taking this battlefield perspective, applying that then to looking at what I did for my thesis research, we were rather successfully able to locate the wrecks of U-576 and Bluefields associated with the KS-520 convoy battle that Nathan mentioned in the introduction, which only got me thinking more and more about how we could apply this to the study of Mirlo, since we don't know where the wrecks are, or we don't know where the wreck is of the British vessel itself. How could we utilize similar techniques of digital recreations to understand, you know, with the operation occurring proximate to the Chickamaucomico life-saving station, knowing the approximate whereabouts of the U-boats and some of these other wrecks that people are speculating the identities of in the area, maybe there's then another aspect to studying this research that has a level of significance for archaeologists that are looking at naval battlefields. So really sort of broad themes going into figuring out this this particular action. And the action itself starts with the U-117, a German World War I era U-boat. It was a UE-2, a type UE-2, which was a very, very technologically advanced U-boat designed for long-range mine-laying operations. In size, speed, capability, armament, this is almost identical to the U-boats that were operating off of the North Carolina coast in World War II. So even though they were a world war before, they were just as lethal as those that were sent during World War II. This U-boat was one of 10 of this class, and it was sent specifically to the American coast in order to lay mines and attack merchant shipping. So some of the details on this boat is it was 267 feet long, 24 feet wide, 1,500 tons. It had a 13,900 nautical mile range. It carried 12 torpedoes and 42 moored mines. It could travel 16 knots on the surface, around 8 knots submerged. This was a pretty formidable naval vessel to be going after merchant shipping along the eastern seaboard. In the bottom picture, you see the U-boat's captain, young officer named Captain Drozier. Drozier had taken the boat out on a couple of shakedown cruises before being sent on what would ultimately be the U-boat's first and only war patrol. They departed in July of 1918 with instructions to go to the American coast and begin laying mines. So we can plot the course of the U-boat thanks to the fact that the U-boat captains kept logs of where they went. They had a system of coding coordinates. They recorded those coordinates in a logbook along with any activity they observed, any vessels that they were stalking or attacking, and the success of those attacks. U-boat captains measure their success in the tonnage of the vessels that they sink, which they approximate from the size of the vessel when they're sizing it up through their periscopes or through surface attacks. And so they keep detailed records of what, I guess you could say, what they think they're attacking. Nothing has a big name plaque on it for that they know the name of every single vessel they attack. In some cases they do, and in some cases they don't, but it gives you a pretty good record of where they are, and it gives you a pretty good record of what they were doing. So we can plot that course out. Basically, once the U-117 got across the North Atlantic, it needed to establish a couple of minefields, which it did around the New England coast before coming down south to the North Carolina area and establishing a third minefield off of the Wimble Shoals area. So those familiar with the Outer Banks know all about Wimble Shoals, which is a series of sandbars right off of the Chickamaucomico area of that stretch of the Outer Banks there. And it presents an optimal target for a minefield in the sense that it sort of juts out into the shipping lane, and boats coming around Hatteras are going to need to also avoid the Wimble Shoals area. So you have a sort of known area where ships are going to be traveling. You don't want to, if you're a merchant captain, go way off into the ocean and then come back towards your point of destination. You want to have as short of a course as possible, especially through a hostile area. And so it kind of creates a bottleneck there that the U-boats were anticipating in laying mines accordingly. So as the U-boat was coming through the area, It laid a series of mines, and in the days surrounding 16 August, it attacked a couple of vessels, small sailing vessels, started mining operations, and then on 16 August, Mirlo was attacked or encountered one of these mines that the U-117 had laid. And then in the days after, the U-117 continued attacking along the coast up until September of 1918, when it called for an underway replenishment, getting all of its supplies replenished, then left the American coast and on back to Europe. So there's varying accounts of what happened on those days and a lot of ambiguity surrounding it. What's known is that the U-117 was in the area. What's known was that Mirlo was hit, sunk, and the crew, most of them, were rescued. But the specific details surrounding the attack remain somewhat of a mystery. Now, an interesting side note to the story of U-117 is that though it returned to Europe, at the end of the war, the vessel was surrendered by the Germans to the British and ended up in the hands of the Americans. The Americans brought it back across the Atlantic and then used it to promote the Victory Loan campaign in the post-war years. So you would be able to, if you flip through newspapers along the eastern seaboard around 1919, you would see ads such as this inviting the public to come tour one of those German rascals that was out laying mines off of the eastern seaboard. And in addition to using it as a public event to drum up support, it was also deconstructed and studied by the U.S. Navy, studied to the extent that following the Billy Mitchell tests on the aerial bombardment of surface vessels, it only sort of logically followed that they would want to understand the effects of aerial bombardment on submarines, the result being that they found that it was equally, if not more, devastating to a submarine to get bombed than it was for a ship. And so in 1921, the U-117 was towed off of Cape Henry, attacked by aerial bombardment, and sunk. So the U-boat came to rest not far from where it had attacked and left so many other vessels on the bottom of the ocean along the eastern seaboard. So that story happens in a pretty short time span, 1916 from when it was built to 1921 when it was destroyed. It's kind of interesting that the story of Mirlo is equally as succinct in so much as that it was built, operated for a couple of years, and then shortly thereafter was sunk. And when we talk about the origin of the Mirlo as a vessel, we get into a lot of superlatives with respect to who built it, where it was built, the type of vessel that it was, the equipment that was put on it. You can go down a rather comical list of sort of firsts or mosts, if you will, where it was built, begun construction in 1916 at the Sir James Lang and Sons shipyard in Sunderland in the UK, along the eastern coast of UK here, which by the end of World War II was the largest or longest operating shipyard in the world. So it operated continuously from 1793 past the Second World War. The vessel was built for a Norwegian shipping company that at the time had the largest shipping network in the world. The builder, or the head of the company in charge of the building, was the son of Sir James Lang, who achieved knighthood by building these great ships at the large shipyard in the largest shipbuilding part of London at the time. His son, Hugh Lang, became famous by making tankers. So the Lang family had achieved somewhat of a prominence in the shipbuilding community. And then to add to that, the engines and boilers that were equipped on the Mirlo were done by the Marine Engine Works of George Clark, which was then the largest marine engine supplier in the Sunderland area, was also famous for building the first iron ship and the first steam engine in the area. So you start piling on all these neat layers of sort of firsts and mosts with people associated, or the companies and individuals associated with the building of, at the time, what had become sort of a modern tanker design. So you're having the ship built in 1916, the carriage of petroleum in bulk really coming into economic prominence following the 1850s, and a rather interesting technological interplay between the emergence of steel shipbuilding and the emergence of steam engines on ships for carrying passengers or for carrying large cargoes, then sort of countered with the dangers associated with carrying very volatile compounds in bulk next to coal-fired engines on vessels powered by oil-powered lamps, and so on and so forth. And so in somewhat of an anachronism, the earliest tankers ended up being wooden vessels carrying paraffin casks full of oil. It was actually safer and more reliable to carry them on the slower wooden sailing vessels than it was to put them on these big steamships until a couple of very key technological improvements had been figured out. The most obvious of those being the placement of the engine machinery in the boilers within the hull of the vessel. Now, your typical sort of freighter would have the engine and machinery in the midships area underneath the bridge, whereas in your sort of standard tanker design, they put those all the way in the aft portion of the vessel, separated from the remainder of the vessel in the carriage area by a series of sort of fireproof bulkheads. They developed a system of electrical lighting so they would no longer need oil-powered lamps to light the vessels. Then they would use steam heat to maintain a constant temperature of the oil cargo, because they found out after carrying oil for a while that the change in temperature of the water in which the oil is being carried in along the sides of the hull of the ship changes the temperature and the density of the oil. As the oil becomes more dense in colder water, it contracts, voids space in the cargo holds, and then begins to move around through those voided spaces. So a series of bulkheads and cofferdams were established to prevent the movement of the liquid cargo, and then a heating system was established to maintain a constant temperature. So if you loaded a cargo of oil in, say, the Gulf of Mexico and then took it all the way to the North Atlantic, those drastic changes in water temperature wouldn't compromise the stability of the vessel by changing the density and volume of the liquid cargo that you were carrying. So this ended up being the modern tanker design that was coming out of these Sunderland shipyards. And if you can imagine how important this was to a nation like Great Britain in a time of war that was depending on petroleum to continue their fight along continental Europe, you can see here this rather famous picture of King George coming to the Sir James Lang and Sons shipyard during 1917 and touring it and taking a picture there with one of the young rivet heaters that would carry the hot rivets to the shipbuilders. And just some of the general scenes along the river there as these big ships were being built, these big modern ships were being built for service in England. Now, unfortunately, because of the Mirlo's short service life, laid down in 1916 and then sunk 1918, there are very few pictures of the vessel. I haven't seen any, although I presume that somewhere out there there are pictures of Mirlo. The pictures that I've been able to find are those of the same class, the same type of ship that was ordered by the Norwegian Shipping Company from the Lang shipyards, and those are Mendocino and Montana. So we can see both a starboard and port profile view of the vessel in that arrangement of engines and machinery in the aft of the vessel, as evidenced by the smokestack, and then a bridge forward, the piping along the deck there going to the various carriage areas for the oil inside the vessel, and then a small forecastle up front. So when we were looking at the Green Buoy wreck and then looking ahead to hopefully locating these vessels, we were figuring that we needed to develop some type of schematic that would represent what the vessel would look like. So we went into the Lloyd's listing for the ship, and there's lots of information contained in a Lloyd's listing that gives us some overall dimensions, types of machinery, so on and so forth. So the sort of vital statistics of the Mirlo are that it was 425 feet long, 57 feet wide, had a depth of hold of 33 feet. It had a forecastle above the main deck that was 40 foot long, a 28 foot long bridge up forward, and a stern deck that was 101 feet long. So we laid all that out to scale. Various areas of the outer hull were double hulled, such that along the bottom of the vessel and then within parts of the stern and forward part of the vessel, it could carry water ballast to balance off any discrepancies in the weights of cargoes. It had electric lighting, and it had a triple expansion steam engine as supplied by the George Clark Engine Works. That steam engine was powered by four Scotch boilers, those four boilers being able to produce enough steam that the engine could drive the ship at a maximum speed of 11 knots. In addition to just the basic design and construction of the tanker, it was also defensively armed. And I put defensive in quotations because it has a specific connotation within the context of U-boat activity in the First World War. in that German U-boats, at least initially, were obliged to follow what are called prize rules, sort of a gentleman's way of prosecuting naval warfare when you're going to attack non-war ships, where U-boats were supposed to, you know, spot a vessel, fire a proverbial shot across the bow, and then having warned the vessel to stop, inform them that that vessel was then going to be boarded. Once boarded, the crew of the U-boat would inspect the manifests, look at the cargo, determine the nationality of the ship, where it was coming from, where it was going, and determine that it either did or did not belong to a belligerent nation and whether it would or would not then sink the vessel. In the event that it determined that it would sink the vessel, it would allow the crew to get into their lifeboats, have their lifeboats away, in some cases even providing them with provisions and maps on how to get back to land, and so setting them off in a safe manner with the crew off the boat, then going and setting charges or getting back into the U-boat and firing with their deck gun or a torpedo to then sink the unmanned merchant vessel. So the notion of defensive armament then is that if a U-boat is going to surface, hail you, and go through this procedure of determining whether or not it was going to sink you, you have an option there with something as simple as a single deck gun to defend yourself, in that the U-boat in that situation is particularly vulnerable. It has a large outer hull, which is basically a sheet metal shape that makes the vessel hydrodynamic, and inside of that is a big tube, a pressure hull that is what carries the people inside of it and what withstands the pressure of the depths that the U-boat is supposed to dive to. If you can put even a single shell through that pressure hole, you've effectively neutralized the U-boat's ability to dive and therefore conduct U-boat operations. So your defensive armament can simply be that you can deter the U-boat from approaching you by firing your gun at it. So a lot of British merchant vessels at this time were equipped with defensive armament, and not just given a gun, but then also given a crew of British Navy sailors to man the guns and to be on the merchant vessel. So though they weren't specifically commissioned as warships, they were certainly not going into a war zone unwittingly, nor were they going in unprepared. In addition to the 4-inch gun that was put on the stern of Mirlo, it also had what was at the time a top secret minesweeping apparatus invented by the British, an inventor named Commander Burney, which borrowed some technology from commercial fishing to develop a anti-mine device that could be deployed off of a single vessel and run. So unlike the standard U-boat attack where the U-boat itself is going to engage the ship that it intends to destroy by physically encountering it, a mine attack can happen somewhat unsuspecting, in that a ship is traveling along, encounters the mine, and then has to deal with whatever damage is wrought, or in a worst case scenario, the ship actually sinking. So there's not a way to really defend this with defensive armament other than putting something that can remove the mines. And it was unfeasible throughout the entire theater of operations to have minesweepers going around to all these areas and sweeping these channels clear on a regular enough basis to ensure that they were free of mines. So the logical solution then was not to try and sweep all the mines, but to equip the individual ships with the ability to do so themselves, at least through a narrow area in which they were traveling, and keep that safe. So the paravane system was used and tested by the British. It achieved such substantial success that by 1917, the Royal Navy ordered all ships, whether they be warships or merchant vessels under the command of the Admiralty, that traveled at greater than 12 knots to carry this paravane system. And they kept it under such a veil of secrecy that oftentimes the captains of the merchant vessels didn't even know what the word paravane meant. They were familiar with the system by the sort of vernacular term that was used with the commercial fishing gear, the otter gears, the otter boards that were used to spread the paravane out in the water. As the water moved off it, it would put tension on the cables and then allow these cutter heads to sweep out to the sides. Those cables would then catch the mooring of a mine, moving that mooring to a cutting implement within the paravane that would sever the mooring to the mine, and then the mine would float harmlessly to the side of the ship as the ship passed by. So they were kept under secrecy, and we know that the Mirlo was equipped with these because in his post-incident report, the captain, Captain Williams, reported prior to the attack that they were traveling at full speed with their otter gears deployed, meaning that they had their paravane out and they were sweeping for mines as they came through this area. So if we look at a couple more of these pictures, we can see here that it's a fairly substantial apparatus that was equipped on these vessels. So here's the paravane itself, and then here's all of the equipment on the bow that would be needed to spread these and launch them from the deck of the boat. Also another clue in the event that a potential Mirlo site is located would be to look for the presence or absence of this system on the bow of the vessel. So with this defensive armament, the Mirlo was operating along the Atlantic coast in August of 1918. On 10th of August, it departed New Orleans with a cargo full of gasoline and fuel oil bound for London. It had two stops to make before it could get to London. It needed to stop at Norfolk and then again at New York to top off the coal supply that was used to fire the boilers to propel the ship. So it had a couple of these little jumps to make before it could finally cross the North Atlantic. And at the helm of the vessel was Captain William Williams, a rather renowned, well-reputed merchant captain who in 1915 had actually been publicly awarded by President Woodrow Wilson for his coming to aid of another merchant vessel just in regular peacetime duty. So he was certainly a seasoned and well-experienced and well-reputed captain when he took Mirlo on this cruise from New Orleans out to London by way of Norfolk and New York. So on the morning of the 16th, 10 days underway, the tanker rounded Cape Hatteras and began traveling north in a course parallel to Hatteras Island. Now, an interesting footnote to that is that 10 days prior, they would have had a aid to navigation off of Diamond Shoals, being the Diamond Shoals lightship. 10 days prior, the U-140, while attacking another merchant vessel, the Mirac, intercepted a radio transmission from the lightship that was watching the U-140 attack the Mirac, report the position of the U-boat. Well, the U-boat commander wasn't too excited that a ship was reporting his position over an open radio channel, so the U-boat commander broke from his attack on Mirac, went over, sank the lightship. Once the lightship was sunk, it went back and finished off the Mirac. In the interval, most of the crew of the Mirac were able to get out of Dodge and move away from the vessel. So just a few days later, as Mirlo is coming around Cape Hatteras, there is no longer a Diamond Shoals lightship. So they're rounding the Cape in the light of day and then traveling at full speed at a course parallel to Hatteras Island. Now at this time, in the Chickamaconico life-saving station, on watch is Leroy Midget. And Leroy is watching ships going down the coast and ships going up the coast. On the afternoon of 16 August, he watches a merchant vessel traveling on a southward course, presumably from Norfolk, traveling down the coast towards the Gulf of Mexico. And as he's watching this course of this vessel pass to the south of the station, he sees then another tanker traveling the opposite course coming north. At 4:30 p.m., he notices an explosion, and an explosion so violent that it partially obscured the sight of this vessel from the crow's nest of the Chickamaconico life-saving station by this giant geyser of water that came up from the vessel. On board Mirlo, a very, very violent explosion erupted in the number two tank. Now, the way they numbered the cargo tanks on these tankers was from stern to bow. So the number two tank would have been close to the stern of the vessel on the vessel's starboard side. This explosion was so violent that it knocked out the engine room, it knocked out the electrical power, and it knocked out the communications equipment. The only thing the captain had left was the steerage of the vessel. So without being able to move itself under power and only being able to steer, the captain did pretty much the only thing he could do, which was point it towards shore and let that momentum of the vessel carry it towards shallow water, towards shore, towards the life-saving station, and towards safety. Meanwhile, the crew of the Chickamaconico life-saving station has pretty much sprung into full action. So within a matter of minutes, Coast Guardsman Leroy Midget has alerted the station's keeper, Captain John Allen Midget, or Captain Johnny, as they called him. And Captain Johnny orders all hands. They're going to crew the surf boat, launch their surf boat. He's placed a call to the next southernmost life-saving station or Coast Guard station at the time, the Gull Shoals station, for the Gull Shoals crew to then come to their aid as well. The crew of the Coast Guard station, however, had no easy task. They had to travel through the sand, through the surf, to launch their lifeboats, while meanwhile, additional explosions were breaking out on board the Mirlo. So as the Mirlo was steering by rudder, trying to come to shore, a second explosion in the stern of the vessel erupted and the rudder jammed, sending the vessel on a spiraling turn, just a wide arcing turn, to port side. So now the vessel's doing circles around the Wimble Shoals light buoy, as it now no longer even has steerage. By this time, Captain Williams has ordered his crew to make ready the lifeboats for launching, and as this arc is happening, the third time that it comes around to port, a third explosion breaks out amidships, and the ship breaks into two pieces, the cargo of fuel oil spilling out into the ocean around the vessel, it catching fire and creating a rather unpleasant situation for anyone in the vicinity of it. So as this third explosion happens, all hands are ordered to abandon ship. The port and starboard lifeboats were filled and lowered first, Captain Williams remaining on board till all of his crew were getting off, himself waiting to take the last and third lifeboat off of the vessel. The port lifeboat was launched, got away from the burning wreckage, but then had the rather unfortunate task, or the rather difficult task, of rowing in order to get away from the flames that were spreading out in the water around them. And row they did. They rowed literally for their lives. The fires got so intense around the lifeboat at times that in order to fight the flames, the crew in this lifeboat had to take their clothes off, wet them, and then use their clothes to douse the flames as the flames would whip up around the boat. Compared to what happened to the crew on the starboard boat, these guys had it easy. As the starboard boat was being lowered into the water, the tiller that controls the rudder fouled, and as soon as the lifeboat hit the water, it capsized with 15 of Mirlo's crew in it. Upon capsizing, they were not able, obviously, to right the boat, and now they were stuck next to a burning ship on a capsized lifeboat, and the only thing that they could do was hold on for dear life. The air around them being so acrid and the flames whipping up so much that in order to survive, they had to dunk their heads underwater to stay away from the flames, then bring their heads up for a breath of air, that breath of air then being this hot, smoky flame, or hot smoke coming off of the flames in the water around them. And for some time, they managed to do this. Meanwhile, the life-saving crew, having brought their motor lifeboat to the beach, has 18 to 20-foot waves resulting from a storm that had come through the area a few days prior that they have to pass through in order to travel the 5 miles of open water to get to the burning tanker. So they have their lifeboat carried to the surf, and three tries to try and get through these waves, the lifeboat fills with water, has to be brought back ashore, bailed out before it can be launched again. On the fourth try, Captain Johnny and his crew get the lifeboat out into the surf and began motoring the 5 miles to the burning wreckage. The first lifeboat that they come upon is the last lifeboat that was able to get off of Mirlo, that being the lifeboat with Captain Williams and his remaining crew. He sees that they are rather worse for the wear for having themselves to fight to get out of the flames, and they instruct, Captain Johnny instructs Captain Williams to go up to close to the shore, but not to try and land his boat due to the heavy waves. So they begin rowing themselves toward shore, and the Coast Guardsmen continue towards the burning wreckage. Well, off what ended up being the bow section, as it was drifting away from the stern section through the flames, one of the guardsmen thought he spotted a lifeboat. So Captain Johnny, without hesitation, begins steering through these sheets of flames on the water towards, closer and closer, the burning bow of the vessel. Upon arriving at the bow, they found the upturned lifeboat with what had originally been 15 crewmen going underwater and coming up for breaths. By the time they got there, only six remained. All six were plucked from the water, the remaining crewmen having either suffocated or drowned in the interim. Once they had these six crewmen on board their motor surf boat, they began going searching for the final boat. Upon finding it, find the crew so exhausted from rowing that they cannot propel themselves any further. So Captain Johnny takes them under tow, heads toward shore, there finds Captain William's lifeboat still making way toward shore, takes them under tow, and brings this armada of lifeboats back towards the breakers. Getting back through this miles and miles, miles stretch of open water, they have then these 18 to 20 foot waves to land these boats back through. So one at a time, Captain Johnny lands both of the Mirlo's lifeboats and then the motor surf boat safely onto the beaches with the help of the Gull Shoals Coast Guardsmen, where then the crew of the Mirlo are brought ashore, given clothing, food, and aid. That night, the Navy sent down a plane from Norfolk to pick up Captain Williams, and then the next day a patrol boat came down to pick up the 42 surviving members of the Mirlo. Following the action, Captain Johnny and the crew of the Chickamaconico life-saving station were given commendations by the United States Coast Guard. They were awarded British Victory Medals. Captain Johnny got this famous silver cup from the Board of Trade. And then in 1930, the U.S. Coast Guard Commandant awarded all of the guardsmen at the Chickamaconico life-saving station the Grand Crosses of the American Cross of Honor. So they received quite a bit of official recognition in awards for their heroic acts in rescuing the crew of the Mirlo through these fairly adverse conditions. So the mystery remains then of what specifically happened with the attack of U-117 and the tanker. When interviewed after the attack, Captain Williams was adamant that he'd been torpedoed by a German U-boat, although with additional interrogation admitted seeing no U-boat or seeing none of the telltale torpedo wakes, a trail of bubbles that follows behind the torpedo as it's traveling through the water. That then casts some doubt in speculation that perhaps Mirlo had not been torpedoed, but in fact had just hit one of the mines left along Wimble Shoals that U-117 had laid earlier that day. North Carolina historian David Stick, upon reviewing the records himself, determined that at the time U-117 was operating a little bit further north and therefore would not have been in the area and therefore would not have directly attacked Mirlo, and instead it would have encountered a mine. A historian for the National Park Service in the 1960s, a gentleman named Edwin Bars, had a copy of the German U-boat commander's logbook translated into English, and in that logbook, the U-boat commander reported that he got off Wimble Shoals, used the Wimble Shoals light buoy as a waypoint to then lay a string of about 8 mines across the shipping lane offshore of the Wimble Shoals light, and in the process of laying this minefield saw 2 tankers, one southbound, one northbound, the same 2 tankers that Leroy Midget watched on that same afternoon, going southbound, going northbound, broke from mine laying operations, took a line on one of the vessels, fired a torpedo, and caused a catastrophic damage to the vessel, and then just as casual as they had stopped laying mines, went back and finished laying mines. And then in the days after, continued working their way back up the eastern seaboard, staying all the way through about mid-September before going back to Europe. So with that then being a pretty definitive account from the U-boat commander himself, and looking at the list of the U-boat's activities in the days before and after, where it was essentially attacking smaller sailing vessels or smaller merchant vessels, the vessel that it attacked on 16 August would have had to have been one of these vessels that was seen by Leroy Midget traveling off of the Wimble Shoals area. There's an additional detail to this when we consider the presence of the paravane system and the disabling of Mirlo's engines and rudder system with the first and second explosions that might be another perspective on the vessel sinking. Specifically that the first explosion was most likely caused by that torpedo fired by U-117. The second explosion then being a secondary explosion from the cargo igniting and erupting inside the ship. Once the ship began this wide circling turn towards port, once the rudder began jammed, it was circling around the Wimble Shoals light buoy, the same waypoint that the U-117 had used to start dropping mines in this minefield. It was equipped with this large system of cables hanging off the bow that are designed to function properly only when the vessel is going full speed ahead to spread them out and cut mines. It could very well be the case that the third explosion, which ultimately broke Mirlo in two, was actually that of a mine that it encountered, either through simply hitting it or through fouling the mine in the paravane, and the paravane failing to operate in such a way that it cut the mine's mooring and instead brought the mine into the side of the vessel and resulted in the vessel's explosion. So looking at all of these pieces of evidence, it could very well be the case that there are more details to the sinking of Mirlo than the simple, was it sunk by a torpedo? Was it sunk by a mine? It could be a rather interesting, although less definitive, both. In the case that there was a little bit of torpedo and a little bit of mine and a very unlucky tanker that happened into both of them in sort of an ultimate case of wrong time, wrong place. Really, looking at the site itself would provide more definitive forensic evidence to validate any or all of those individual scenarios. And so, what are the future research opportunities? What would be the ultimate goal of locating the vessel and then documenting its remains? Well, going back to the original battlefield perspective, that archaeological research perspective, looking at the vessel as a forensic clue, analyzing the attack and the events would provide a better understanding of it as a singular naval action and how the relationship between the landscape, between the technology, the mines, the paravane, the torpedoes, the U-boat attack played out in a minute-to-minute sort of timeline as the attack happened, but then it also pinpoints a specific location that then goes back to the first two sort of broad themes that we talked about with regards to the presence and activities of the U.S. Coast Guard off of the North Carolina coast, and then the presence and activities of the U.S. Life Saving Service as it was sort of the generation before the modern day Coast Guard. When the Outer Banks Dive Center was researching some of these shipwrecks, Bill McDermott was very, very interested in that Coast Guard history off of the Outer Banks, so much so that we did an archaeological research expedition out to the remains of U.S. Coast Guard cutter Jackson, did a preliminary map of the Coast Guard cutter, and then developed some interpretation tools similar to what NOAA did with some of the U-boats and the vessels lost a little further south during World War II. But there's that potential for merging many of these different levels of heritage awareness, of archaeological research, of historical remembrance in a singular site that has intertwined around it, not just the specific event, but all of these broader themes, which sort of position North Carolina in an area of prominence within the larger maritime sphere as a place where you consistently see these extraordinary events taking place and these very physical links off of the coast here to these more broad global patterns, global situations, whether it's warfare, commerce, all of these events taking place and having a tangible link kind of in the backyard, so to speak, of the Outer Banks. So with that, I've got a couple of slides here that are the sort of obligatory bibliography for all of the images which were so liberally used throughout the presentation. But at this point, I think I'd like to open it up to anybody that has questions.